Now that we can create a plant or identify it as a block that takes some inputs and produces some outputs, we want to create a controller that achieves some purpose. Controllers usually have the form of feedback where the output of the system is read back to compare to a reference, which is where we want to define the system output to be, to create an error signal. That signal is fed to the controller, which now can update the input to the plan and adjust it in order to obtain the goal that we want. So our question is how to create that controller such that the error will be driven to zero. We will explore three methods. First, the root locus analysis, then the controls in state space, and finally, the PID control. The root locus method is based on the transfer function. It is a graphical method where we draw the location of the poles of the system in the complex plane. Those poles of the system are the roots of the denominator in the transfer function. Equivalently, those poles are also the eigenvalues of the matrix A, as we saw in the previous lecture. So, depending on the position of the poles in the complex plane, we can have different options that are depicted in the figure on the right. You can see that when the poles are on the negative real axis, the response of the system will be stable, which means that it will converge to a value. However, when the poles are on the right side plane, the response of the system will be unstable. Now, looking at the imaginary axis, you can see that the value of theta will define how much damping the response of the system will have. So the method of finding a controller will be to set a control system that locates the poles in the left half side of the plane so that it drives the system stable. But also we can define how much component we want in the imaginary axis so that we can drive the system with higher damping or lower damping. If we go back to our block diagram of the system with a controller, we can see that the same way as we defined the transfer function of the plant P, we can create a transfer function of R, which is our set point, to Y, which is our system output, and evaluate that in terms of the transfer function of C and P. Then our closed loop system will have the denominator 1 plus C P. And then, from analyzing that denominator, we can identify the poles of the closed-loop system. Then, if we define C, our controller, as some transfer function of a tuning variable, then we can sweep the tuning variable to find what value it should have in order for the closed-loop system to have the poles located in the place we want. Let's use a proportional controller, C of S equals K, to create a root locus plot. The root locus plot represents the position of the poles of the system for each possible value of K. In this figure, each pole of the system is represented with a different color. So a system has poles in here, here, and here. That's for the closed loop system, but with a controller of k equals 0. Basically, that will be the same as the open loop system of the plant. Now, as we start increasing the value of k, these poles will be moving and be placed in different locations. For example, this one right here will be moving to the left as k increases. This one here will be moving up as k increasing. And this one here will be moving down as k increases. You can see that for the pole in red, we will not have stability problems as we keep increasing k. However, for the pole in green, as k increases, it can reach the right side plane. And same for the pole in blue. As k increases, it will go to the left, but then it will go back to the right side of the plane, making the system unstable. So this plot informs us about what values of k we can use so that the system goes to a stable state. And we know that the limit of the values of k will be given by any of the poles crossing this line. Now, let's find a controller to stabilize our inverted pendulum system using the root locus method. Remember that we got the linearization of the system at the equilibrium point of the upward position as this state space system. We can then compute the transfer function by using Laplace transform. To obtain P, the transfer function of the plant. Now, if we define our controller as C equals k, using the transfer function of the closed loop system, Cp divided by 1 plus Cp, we can get the closed loop transfer function as a function of k and the parameters of the system. Observe that the denominator has k right here. And if we want to get the poles of the system, we want to find the roots of this polynomial, which will end up being a function of k, and the parameters of the system, such as the length of the pendulum, the mass of the pendulum, the gravity term, and the damping term, b. As an example, let's choose some values for B, M, L, and G, and plot the root locus. If you see this axis here, they mark the open loop pulse of the system, which is clearly unstable because this one right here is on the right side of the real axis. But if we observe what happens when we increase the gain of the controller, meaning increasing K to 8, this pole starts shifting to the left, but is still unstable. This other pole shifts to the right, but is still stable. But once we increase the gain further, then the pole will move to the left side plane, making the system stable. Let's see what would be the time response of the system with a gain of K equals 8, and with what will be the response of the system with K equals 12. So, assuming that the pendulum starts at a configuration of 6 degrees, which is close to the equilibrium position, but not the equilibrium position, which guarantees that we could use the linearization. We can see here that the initial position of 6 goes down, oscillates, overshoots a bit, and then goes to 0, converging to the equilibrium position for the gain K equals 12. But for the gain K equals 8, we can barely see the beginning of the time series, and we can see how the position of the pendulum diverges. It is important to note that as we go farther away from the point of operation of our linearization, this response does not really represent the real system anymore. So you need to be careful of what is the range of your variables with respect to the original system and the linearization you're using. As you see, the root locus method is very simple to visualize, and it gives us a clear idea of what will happen to the system as we tune our controls parameter. And also, it is important because there is a set of rules that you can use to create a manual drawing of the root locus plot in a way that you don't need to compute the solution numerically and still get an approximation of what would be the plot of the system. Now let's look at the control in state space. We have the linear system in a state space form, x dot equals ax plus bu. To simplify this explanation, now I will assume that we want to drive the system to x equals 0. Then our error of the system will be equal to x. Now we can create a feedback controller, which will input the system with a value that is function of the error, or function of the state, x. Let's say that u equals minus kx. Then it is easy to replace u in the linear system equation, finding that x dot equals ax plus b times minus kx. And if we factor x from the expression, we find that x dot equals a minus bk factor of x. You can easily observe that a minus bk is a closed loop system matrix similar to the A matrix in our original linear system. Let's call this one A bar. So A bar equals A minus BK. And Then, using the same as we saw before, if we observe the poles of A bar, those are the eigenvalues of A bar, we can identify the stability of the system by observing those eigenvalues. But now, those will be a function of k, and we can tune the values of k to drive those eigenvalues to any location we want. Now let's use full state feedback to stabilize the inverted pendulum. Remember that our linear model is given by this expression, where A is this matrix, B is this matrix. Now we can define our input to the system as U equals KX, where K is K1 and K2. You can see that K1 is telling us how much extra acceleration we need to give to the system for an error in position of the angle of the pendulum. And K2 is the same, but for the velocity of the pendulum. So each one is trying to correct for a different state variable. Now we compute A bar, where A bar equals A minus BK, and we get this matrix that is a function of our parameters of the system, so G, L, B, and M that we know, and some unknowns that are K1 and K2 that are the parameters that we want to tune so that we can drive the eigenvalues of A bar to the desired location. Let's evaluate the eigenvalues numerically using some constants as we used before. B equals 1, M equals 1, L equals 1, and G equals 9.8. So we get these two expressions, one for each eigenvalue. You can see that the eigenvalues are conjugate pairs. And you can see that the value of the eigenvalues will be function of both K1 and K2. So if we draw the complex axis, we can try to think of where would the eigenvalues be. Since we know that they are complex pairs, both should have the same value in magnitude of the real axis, and then opposite values of sign of opposite signs for the imaginary axis. So the only way we can place those poles is by defining them so that the imaginary value has the same magnitude. Let's try, for example, real value minus 2 and imaginary value plus and minus 1. With this, we can solve for K1 and K2, obtaining K1 equals 14.8 and K2 equals 3.0. And this will be the response of the system for an initial position of 6 degrees, similar to what we did before in the root locus problem. And we observe how the error tends to 0 so that the system is stabilized. You can choose different values of the desired eigenvalue so that you will solve for other values of K1 and K2 and drive the system perhaps with a response that is more oscillatory, so that is an underdamped system. You can see that the full state feedback gives us more flexibility in terms of where to place the poles than the root locus method, but it is more complicated as it needs to be evaluated numerically and you cannot use the graphic method as we had before. Finally, another common technique is the PID controller. That controller uses three different type of controls integrated in one. The first one is a proportional control that drives the output to the desired value. This proportional control is the equivalent of a spring. And it is similar to what we did in our previous sections. Then we have a derivative gain that is used to reduce the oscillations. This is equivalent to a damping of the system. And finally, there is an integral gain, which is used to eliminate the steady state error. The PID control will change the order of the final system, as it is computing a derivative term and also integrating the error. As a homework for this lecture, I suggest that you implement the PID controller as both a transfer function and a state space representation. Then, with these representations, you can compute the response of the linearized system as we had before, and then you can also simulate the full response of the nonlinear system. With this, we got to the end of our introductory lecture of control theory. We studied how to create models, how to transform from nonlinear state space into linear state space. We use transfer functions for the root locus method. We observe the stability of the system. We use block diagrams as well as the differential equations to describe the system. And we implemented controls in using the root locus method, the full state feedback. And we also mentioned the PID control that will be left for you as an exercise. Thanks for watching.